cornea. You are aware the skin and the brain are evolved from the same origin like ectodermum. So developmentally, the skin is the surface of the brain. As it is already mentioned by our secretary, there are four primary functions are, one is the barrier function, immune surveillance, temperature control, and cutaneous sensation. There are some main cells are there doing some wonderful functions like melanocytes, keratinocytes, Langerhans cells, and Merkel cells. So it's the skin is also a
platform. Jalil sir, slide is not moving. Yes.
Sorry for that. So this is the skin, the neonatal skin is an unique one. Of course, there is a lot of difference between the neonatal skin and the adult skin. A special mention about the preterm skin. So what is the key points is, there is a preservation of skin integrity to have a healthy skin. We have to reduce the risk factors in order to prevent the diseases. And we have to educate the parents about the neonatal skin. If you make the regular rounds, majority of the questions, second to the breastfeeding aspect, the skin related issues that is arising from the mother and the attenders. How is neonatal skin is different? It is already mentioned, there is a lot of difference between the adult and the neonatal skin. You have the statum corneum is a very important one. It consists of the epidermis, dermis, and the hypodermis, which has got a unique function. And you have 10 to 20 layers in adult, whereas in the first year, there is a 30% thinner. And it is different in the preterm infants. And this will give the increased fluid loss and it reduces the electrolyte imbalance and it protects the thermoregulation. And dermis is thinner and underdeveloped in a neonate. For giving a proper neonatal care or preventing the neonatal skin injury, there is a module or a tool that is developed by objective skin assessment, that is the neonatal skin condition score, NSCS. This consists of three areas where you have to give a score for dryness, erythema, and breakdown. That is one score for a normal and no signs of dry skin, and the two for the dry skin with visible scarring, and score three for very dry skin with crackling and fissure present. If you see erythema, one is the no evidence of erythema, visible erythema, and visible erythema more than 50% of the body surface. And if you see a breakdown, there is none evident, if you have one score, and a small or localized area, you give a two score, and if it is an extensive one, you give a score of three. So depending upon the score assessment by the practitioner or the staff who is in the NICU, you have to interpret the result. A single score of three in one area or a combined score of six and above. This skin needs attention. So if it is more than six, you have to consider for a dermatology referral. Most of the time, the neonatal skin disorders are a transient, or it may have a life-threatening situation where the practitioner has to understand or learn how to identify the life-threatening skin lesion. How often you assess neonatal skin assessment? It has to be assessed either daily or more frequently as clinically indicated. And neonates at increased risk of systemic infection and longer hospital stay will be identified properly. The more the hospital stay, the more the contact, more the intervention by the staff nurse or the healthcare personnel, the more risk for the neonates. This is a study in 2016 in Australian study, which is a wonderful study considering the gestational weight and the examination point. And this is a study correlate very well with the risk, how to predict the risk of which neonates develop the preventable injury. So now, after assessing the neonatal score, some of the condition where you commonly encountered in a day-to-day practice. This, of course, the nappy care. What are all the risk factors? There is an increase. This has already been covered by our Secretary General. There is an increased moisture, prolonged contact with irritant, and an alkaline skin surface, frequent stooling, antibiotic use, malabsorption, opiate withdrawal, abnormal rectal sphincter tone. All these are predisposing or risk factors for a baby to develop nappy rash. So how you prevent? Area should be kept clean and dry. Diaper changed as often as necessary and an average 3 to 4 hourly. And skin of the diaper area should be gently cleaned with cotton balls, squares, or washcloth and water alone, or using specially designed wipe. This wipes is in, usually is a commercial over the counter. It is available. As a pediatrician, you should know what should be the ideal wipes before suggesting to the parents. Drying can be achieved through air drying or gentle patting with a dry towel or cotton balls or squares. Diaper area should be clean before bathing. Wipes should contain, it's already mentioned, most of this, this presentation will be a repetition. So wipes should be contained pH buffers to maintain slight acidity of the skin and should be free of potential irritants such as alcohol, fragrant, essential oil, soap, and detergents, especially the example like sodium lauryl sulfate, and they should contain well-tolerated preservative. How to clean the baby at bath? Clean with a clean, sterile cloth to remove the blood clots and meconium. Should not attempt to remove vernix from the body. So you all know the importance of vernix. It is the protective layer. And as far as possible, you postpone the bathing as per the NNF guidelines. It can result in trauma to skin and increase the chances of infection if you remove the vernix casseosa. Then the timing or the nature of bathing. Routine bathing in the hospital should be avoided. I think the NNF has given a standard guideline when to give a bath and who are all the candidate to give an early bath like that. So risk of cross infection and hypothermia, instead it can be sponged, can be bathed once discharged at home. So if you are giving bath at home, what you should do? This is a study. This is preferable to washing with a cloth. As a part of evening routine, bathing may be considered to help improve the sleep, evening bathing. Frequency of bathing and time of day should be based on individual need in consultation with the family, usually 2 to 3 times a week. Should last for 5 to 7 minutes on routine. What is the safety message you can do while doing the bathing at home? Bath should be located in a safe place. Microbiological contamination should be avoided by keeping the bath and bath toys closer. Water temperature, it is between 37 degrees to 37.5 degrees centigrade. Depth of water should be the infant's hips, which is around 5 centimeters. Washcloth may be used to cover or splash water onto belly to maintain the body heat. Room air should be around 21 to 24 degrees centigrade. And more important, baby should not be left alone in the bath, and young children should not be allowed to wash the baby. If oils are used, a mat should be placed in the bath, which should also be disinfected regularly. If oils are used, you should be very careful so that the slipping of the baby is always there. Anything the baby may slip from your hand. So there is a special mention about the preterm infant. And consider the weight, gestational age, and severity of illness while giving the preterm baby. For neonate, less than 32 weeks, the bathing is recommended. Warm water only in the first 2 weeks. Avoid rubbing. For a neonates more than 32 weeks, the pH neutral or slightly acidic cleanser may be utilized. Neonates may be bathed every 2 to 3 days. Use warm, sterile when areas of skin breakdowns are evident. Don't rub the baby. If skin is dry, flaking, or cracked after the bath, an emollient may be applied to the skin, that is immediately after bath. Whether you give water alone or liquid cleanser during the bathing. There's more about commercially available liquid cleansers. Baby skin may be cleansed with water alone by adding the cleanser appropriately formulated liquid cleanser. That is, there are free known irritants and neutral mild acidic between the 6 to 7. Whether majority of the mothers, they will ask whether you should put the powders to be used or not. In general, powders should not be recommended. The American Pediatric Association recommends against using the baby powder. It concerned with talc, natural mineral ingredients of traditional baby powder. Because of the possible inhalation risk and potential harm to the lungs. In part, this is due to talc small easily and inhaled particles can travel to the lungs and cause trouble. So in a cornstarch containing alternatives to traditional baby powder can be used. Proper application is the most critical factor. Put the powder on hands first, away from your body and not directly or near the babies. To prevent skin irritation, don't allow the powder to build up. At every diaper change, wash away any powder that may be accumulated, especially on the folds of your baby's skin. So before applying powder, you in a diaper, you please wash away the existing application. A word about the disinfectants. A very little data is available in particular for preterm neonatal skin. If a disinfectant is required in a neonate less than 14 days of age or less than 30 weeks of gestation, gentle cleans of the skin with a sterile water after the procedure is sufficient. Whereas in case of preterm neonate, chlorhexidine gluconate aqueous solution, that is 0.1%, can be used. Avoid shown povidone iodine and isopropyl alcohol. Only recommended disinfectant in a preterm neonate is chlorhexidine gluconate. Better avoid povidone iodine and isopropyl alcohol because it can cause a chemical burns in a preterm baby. Then the most important thing is in a day-to-day practice is how you are going to give an umbilical care. So routinely, you don't apply, there is no role for any application of oil, powder, or ointment. Keep the cord area open and dry. Do not use alcohol wipe because the earlier use of alcohol wipes can result in a delayed separation and we may get the delayed separation correlating to the immune deficiency. So all the time you keep the cord area open and dry. Clean with water and a pH neutral cleanser if soiled with urine or stool. Fold the nappy down below the umbilicus. Many times I observed the commercially available diapers are covered with the umbilicus showing that the air can enter like that. And during the phototherapy side, the majority of the healthcare workers, they cover it. So you always fold the nappy below the umbilicus in order to aerate that, and also during the phototherapy, you can expose as much as the skin surface to the light. Cord clamp may remain in situ until its separation. It has to be separated. Normally, the cord will fall on a 5-6 days, and you don't apply any pressure to separate the cord. Avoid exposing the peri-umbilical skin to chemicals in order to prevent the peri-umbilical burns. So I already mentioned the folding of the diaper should be in a proper manner so that we should expose the peri-umbilical. You should not expose the peri-umbilical area. So regular assessment is necessary to differentiate between the normal umbilical cord heating and the potential problem, including the infection. In your regular day-to-day practice, you have to inspect the umbilicus, see there is any infection signs up there, or a peri-umbilical redness is there. So they coming to the umbilical cord, the WHO organization released a new guideline on postnatal care. So it recommends daily chlorhexidine, that is 7.1 chlorhexidine application, delivering 4% chlorhexidine application to the umbilical cord stem during the first week of life is recommended for newborn. So it recommends clean, dry cord care for a newborn, both in health facility and at home. SAR has already pointed about the emollients. The emollients restore lipid levels, improve hydration, preserve natural moisturizing factors, and offer significant buffering capacity to normalize the skin pH and maintain the skin microbiome, which the next faculty has to talk about the role of microbiome in preventing the maintaining the skin safety. Apply an emollient daily at the first sign of dryness or any signs of fissures are there. Emollient use is not associated with negative thermal effect or burns and may be used in conjunction with phototherapy or in the heat, radiant heat. Emollient should contain well-tolerated preservative. Emollient use may interfere with the use of adhesive. A special note about emollients in a preterm neonate. Some evidence state that the prophylactic emollient used in preterm neonate weighing less than 750 grams or less is associated with an increased risk of infection. So emollient use in this population should be weighed against the risk of infection. When you are prescribing emollient in a preterm neonate, you have to weigh the risk versus benefit of emollient usage in a preterm infant. So having thought about this common usage of emollient powder and oil, I will discuss about few skin lesions which you commonly encountered in a day-to-day practice. We can consider this skin lesion in a neonate in a three parts. Majority of the skin lesions are transient, and it does not warrant any interference or any medication. So normally these transient lesions resolve in minutes to hours. What are all the transient lesions? You have the heat rash or malaria, petechiae, and this petechiae usually seen on the presenting parts, scalp and face, and vernix caseosa, we already mentioned about it. It is also a transient skin disorder. And transient vascular phenomena, which is the example is cutis murmurata, where you can see the skin mottling related to the cold exposure. So these are all the transient lesions, which without any intervention results in minutes or 2 hours. There is no need for anything. All you have to reassure the parent, this is a temporary skin lesion. This will disappear on its own without any intervention. And one more thing about the transient vascular phenomena is the hair looking color changes. This you commonly seen, this is a temporary color changes, but positional erythema on the dependent part of the part. And this will also disappear in a matter of time. What are all the short-term? Short-term normal lesions are which will resolve in days to month. You have the commonly, you can see the one or two the temporary transient lesion like erythema toxicum neonatorum. We will come late in the subsequent slides. Neonatal pustular melanosis. These are all the two things you have to be differentiate between the erythema toxicum and the neonatal pustular melanosis and milia, suckling blisters, which develops from infant sucking on the skin. This can even occur in utero while the baby started suckling. And do not go fine hair, which usually seen on the shoulder and the back. And spontaneous fat necrosis, usually seen on the back and the thigh, which is also a benign lesion. You have to look if it is more or if it is a persistent, you have to check the calcium for hypercalciuria. And acne neonatorum is another temporary skin lesion, which disappears or resolves in days to months. The third one is a birthmark or a long-term thermal lesion or other dermal lesion which persists for months to year. Some they do not resolve also. What are all these? That is congenital melanocytic nevi, that is a Mongolian spot, or dermal melanosis, which is large up to 10 centimeters. It's a bluish gray pigment patches on the extremities as well in the lumbar or sacral or buttock region. Usually we see this Mongolian spot in a term babies, occurs with a darker skin. The second one is a nevus simplex, this is a Solomon patch, which is a macular pink to red capillary dilatation that fade with time, occurring on the upper eyelids, forehead, and nape of the neck, that is stroke bite. Then you have the hemangioma, all the capillary or cutaneous hemangioma, which are all the birthmarks or a long-term dermal lesion, sometimes persists for months to years. It is the hemangioma, as you mentioned, is a benign vascular lesion. Then the fourth category is an abnormal or a lesion that require evaluation or observation. This is very important. This is a vesicular lesion. There is differentials of vesicular lesion is a neonatal herpes simplex infection. This has to be distinguished from the erythema toxicum neonatalum. Bullae lesions considered bullous impetigo, aplasia cutis congenita. They may be associated with skull deformity. Nevus flammus, it's a portvine stain. Sometimes you can notice on the face, you have to think about the mucocutaneous disorders or phacomatosis. This is a dark, purple red capillary malformation that does not typically fade on blanching. If involvement near the eye, that is ophthalmic division of the trigeminal nerve, this may be associated with the Sturge-Weber syndrome or Klippel-Trenaway-Weber syndrome. This is an abnormal lesion which you find you have to follow the child carefully. You have to rule out the underlying disorders. Then the next abnormal lesion that require evaluation or observation is nevus sebaceous. It's a yellow hairless plaque on the scalp or the face. It may be associated with epidermal nevus syndromes or carrier of the future skin cancer in 10 to 15% of the cases. Not all the nevus sebaceous, it has a risk of developing future skin cancer. And smooth muscle hamartoma is another abnormal lesion. It is a hyperpigmentation and hypertrichosis overlays a firm nodule with the base. You know all that you can see the cephaloid macule, which you have to see the underlying neurological condition. Coffee with the milk is a tan to brown colored flat macule less than 4 centimeters. It can be seen in the infants up to 30 centimeters in adult, usually located on the trunk. So when you see a cephaloid macule, you have to rule out the underlying neurological disease. Like if it is 6 or more lesions, more than 5 centimeters prepubertal or more than 15 millimeter postpubertal, it is seen associated with neurofibromatosis, tuberous sclerosis, and Albrecht syndrome. So we'll discuss about few neonatal conditions. The erythema toxicum neonatorum. It is, as you see, it's otherwise called the flea bite reaction or flea bite skin. And it's a common condition affecting as many as the babies, especially in a full term neonate. Most prominent are the day 2, and it can lay as late as 2 weeks it can present. Often begins on the face and spread affect the trunk and the limb. The important thing against the neonatal erythema toxicum and the pustularis is it spares the palms and sole. You cannot see an erythema toxicum ETN in palms and sole. That is one important differential point. You have to make it between the fustulosis. It's evident at various combination of erythematous macules, that is flat red patches, papules, small lesions, it can be seen. The eruption typically lasts for several days and it is usually disappear without any medical intervention. How do you treat that neonate is otherwise well and require no treatment? If you are in doubt, if it is a pustular lesion, you can scrap the lesion and see there is a presence of eosinophils in that lesion. Sometimes 15% of this erythema toxicum neonatorum is associated with the blood eosinophilia. So you can correlate, if you are in doubt, you can go for a scrapping of the erythema toxicum neonatorum in order to differentiate between the other one, that is the pustulosis. The next common temporary lesion is a neonatal melia. It is usually seen over the tip of the nose. It affects 40 to 50% of newborn babies. Few to numerous lesions are there. It's a harmless cyst present at tiny piece, white bumps just under the surface of the nose or the skin of the nose. It has to be inside the mouth, it is called the Epstein folds, or in the palate, suborn nodules. Majority of the during the rounds, you can pick up this melia, which is a temporary skin lesion which warrants no treatment. It disappears on its own. All you have to reassure the parents. The lesions will heal spontaneously within a few weeks of birth. This is again the pityosporum folliculitis, commonly we see as a neonatal acne or a milk spot. It affects babies within the first week of life. It's an increased activity of the neonate. The sebaceous glands causes inflammation and folliculitis. What are all the clinical features? The erythematous dome-shaped papules and superficial pustule rise in crops, commonly affecting the cheek, nose, and forehead. This rash is not itchy. What is the treatment for this neonatal acne? Will resolve within weeks without treatment, or maybe you can treat a course with ketoconazole sample diluted with 1:1 with water, apply with a cotton bud twice a day, rinse up with water after 10 minutes. So this is a neonatal acne. Very rarely it requires, it warrants application with the antifungal treatment. This is a heat rash. You can see the malaria, and you can see the cyst-like lesions. It is arising from the occlusion of the sweat gland. In neonate, the lesions are commonly appear over the neck and groin, but it also seen on the face. What is the clinical features? It is a small one to three millimeter papules. Sometimes you can have a vesicles or a papular lesion also. What is the treatment? It removed from the heated surface environment or adjust with the incubator temperature. Cool bathing or apply cold compress is necessary. Topical steroid may be used to facilitate relief if the condition is not resolved. It's also a temporary lesion. This is cradle cap, commonly seen on the presenting part of the scalp. It is otherwise called, we call it as a seborrheic dermatitis. It's a thick white yellowish scale. In addition to the scalp, it can also occur on the back of the neck, diaper area, armpit, eyelids, and the more. Cradle cap is only made worse by applying. If you apply, start applying oils and lotion, it will become worse. So you have to find out the underlying issue with cradle cap is the overproduction of sebum, an oily substance naturally occurring on the skin that keeps the skin moisturized. So what is the treatment? Removing the scales with soft brush and washing with a dandruff shampoo daily for 1 or 2 weeks. It is just apply as a dandruff shampoo, this cradle caps will use. Usually we don't recommend anything during the regular neonatal period. You can see all you have to reassure them, you can wait and watch. In many cases, cradle cap will go away on its own. Then Sar has mentioned about the massage therapy with various oils, and massage has several positive effects. It's a part of Gangaru mother care, especially in early stimulation technique, early stimulation protocol, we follow this massage. Which has got several positive effects. It increases the weight gain, better sleep-wake pattern, and enhanced neuromotor development, and better emotional bonding, and reduce the rate of nosocomial infection, and it reduces the mortality in the hospitalized patient. It's a long-term impact. Still, it is not known about that. So the massage is recommended, especially in preterm babies. The effect of bone mineralization physical activity in a preterm infant needs further evaluation. The short-term benefits of decreasing the pain before heel prick injury. So whenever you are doing the heel prick injury, there is a short-term benefit for this massage therapy. There is a significant increase in vagal activity. Improved gastric motility leads to better absorption of the nutrient, resulting in better weight gain. Preterm infant who received massage therapy, that is 1 to 15 minutes for 5 days, they showed increase in serum insulin and serum growth factor 1 levels. And this also shows the decrease the level of stress by decreasing serum cortisol and norepinephrine and increase the urinary excretion of epinephrine and norepinephrine. This is the benefit of massage therapy while giving. How to give the massage therapy to the baby? That should be a conducive environment while giving the massage therapy. Room with soft, light, warm temperature and low noise levels. Ideally 45 minutes to 1 hour after a feed to avoid regurgitation or vomiting of the feed. It should involve the entire body starting from the head, neck and trunk and the extremity. A firm stroke with flat finger is used during the massage therapy. Moderate pressure is shown to be better than the light pressure in terms of weight gain. Two phases of tactile stimulation. One is a baby is placed prone and 12 strokes of 5 seconds each is provided starting from the head, neck and shoulder to buttock. What is the another one? The baby is placed supine for 12 strokes for 5 seconds. Each was given starting from the face, cheeks, chest, abdomen, upper limb, and the lower limb and palm and sole. The third phase consists of kinesthetic stimulation in which the alternate flexor and extension movements are performed at major joints, especially the ankle, knee, and the elbow, and the shoulder. So you have the tactile stimulation and the kinetic stimulation while applying the massage to the baby, and this proves a definite benefit to the baby, especially the preterm baby. So massage can be interrupted for a minute when the baby passes stools or urine or cry excessively. This should not be a continuous process. It should be interrupted if the baby passes stool or urine or if the baby cries excessively. Sarg has mentioned about the usage of oil. There are various oils you can see. Currently speaking, you should not apply oil except the one what we are going to mention. In a well-designed study, 3 groups, namely the coconut oil, mineral oil, and placebo were compared in infants weighing between 1.5 to 2 kilos who received massage therapy 4 times a day for a duration during the first month. Infants who received coconut oil massage showed a better weight gain velocity as compared to the mineral oil. So it is only recommended massage oil is the coconut oil, that is the virgin coconut oil, without any commercially available or any artificial flower are used in that coconut oil. What is the usage of sesame oil? Infant massaged with sesame oil showed greater improvement in anthropometric parameters as compared to mustard and the mineral oil. Olive oil damages the skin. There are a lot of questions while during the postnatal period whether they can apply olive oil or not. This olive oil significantly damages the skin barrier and therefore has the potential to promote the development of exacerbated existing atopic dermatitis. Usually olive oil, I won't prescribe because it may alter the skin complexion if you apply olive oil in a longer duration of period. What about the mustard oil? Eczematous and vesicular dermatitis are known and irritant reaction being much more common than the allergic dermatitis if you use the mustard oil. That is allyl isothiocyanate is the chief antigen in the mustard oil, which is a volatile chemical capable of causing contact dermatitis. Apart from these irritant reaction, mustard oil may also cause defect in the barrier function, especially in the stratum corneum by incorporation of the disproportionate lipids in the intracellular layer. All this can be very well explained by our Secretary General about the sesame, mustard oil, etc. So what are all the key messages? The skin care is essential part of holistic care of the neonate. Everyone know about what are all the temporary lesion, what are all the self-limiting lesion, what are all the life-threatening lesion, how to assess the skin skin problem or a skin healthy skin by applying the neonatal skin score, and the assessment is by the NCS score, and early therapy should be the goal. This NCS score is quite an interesting tool. It is designed in Australian scientists, and I think many of our NICU should have this NCS scale in order to assess, in order to pick up the at-risk baby. So the neonatal skin is different from pediatric or adult skin and have many benign skin lesion. The routine practices like bathing, nappy care, touch and massage therapy should be emphasized to the parents on routine basis. The key role or the key objection message for this module is to we as a practitioner to identify this and convince or counsel the parents about the temporary or a transient lesion, benign nature of the skin, and counsel the parents about the transient or the benign nature in order to avoid a tension or a tension-free postnatal life, especially to the attenders and the parent. So thank you very much. I must thank the organizers for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, Vinod. Any question can be answered.
Okay. Thank you, sir. You can stop the sharing.